Dear friends, this is episode number 45 of the Limitation Act. In episode 44, I have read section 18 and explained the meaning. I have just read 19 but did not explain the meaning. Now we will go to 19 again. Almost the same wording or same principles will apply to 19 also. Sometimes it may overlap. The decisions are uniform to the effect that 18 and 19 are not mutually exclusive. Sometimes it may overlap. And what is this 19? Payment on account of a debt or interest on legacy. Here also, by explanation, debt does not include money payable under a decree. Debt before the decree, that is it. Not after the decree. After the decree, there is no question of section 19 coming in. Say, for example, you borrowed money from me. 1 lakh. You executed a promissory note in my favor. So, with whom the promissory note should be kept? It must be kept by me. Then, before the expiry of the period of limitation will be 3 years in such cases. You make a payment. Say for example, 10,000. You make a payment. That payment you made, all right, I said all right, you pay the rest within time. And I note on the promissory note, so and so, today paid 10,000 rupees, date also. Is it enough? No. Why? Is made prescribed before the by the person liable to pay the debt or interest or by liable to pay the debt or legacy or by his agent duly authorized in this behalf. Where payment on account of a debt or interest on legacy is made before the expiration of the period. And then the acknowledgement of payment appears in the handwriting of or in the handwriting signed by the person making the payment. So it must be in the handwriting of, then no signature is, even if there is no signature, that is enough. Or in the writing signed by the person making the payment. So it must be signed. Who must do? The person making the payment should do. So you are liable to pay. Promissory note is in my possession. I must get your signature in the promissory note disclosing this payment. Then only I can claim extension of time. That is the benefit of section 19, fresh period. Otherwise, to save limitation, I can make endorsements thereon. How are you bound by it? You are not bound by it. So I can make manipulation and manipulate things and get the period extended. That is not possible. So it must be in writing, signed by the person making the payment. So the document is in my possession. Your signature must be there in the document. How to do it? I have to get it from you at the time making the payment. Or if I become so clever that I am not writing anywhere, let him pay. True, I can cheat the other man, but at the same time, I will not get fresh period of limitation. That is available only when these conditions are satisfied, otherwise not. Now, where mortgaged land, explanation A, where mortgaged land is in the possession of the mortgagee, the receipt of the rent or produce of such land shall be deemed to be payment. A usufructuary possessory mortgage. I am the mortgager, you are the mortgagee. I execute the mortgage deed. And you are put in possession. of the property with a stipulation that you receive the rents and profits and appropriate it towards the principal amount due, or towards the principal and interest, or interest alone, whatever it is. And then you make payment. How? Make that payment of the receipt of rent or produce of such land shall be deemed to be payment. You receive the rent or profits, that is payment. You need not pay. The stipulation is to adjust towards the principal or interest. And then if that is received, that rents or profits are received, that is payment. Now, so we will go to some decided cases, then it will be very clear. And then apart from that, you have to read the commentaries also. Read and read and read. Then only, see, the decisions which I am giving, only very few. There are thousands and thousands of decisions and the commentaries. We cannot refer to all those things. Each word is subject matter of a commentary in the standard books. B.B. Mitra Limitation Act is there. Or AIR commentaries, that is handy. You can search and find out the decisions and all those things. Now, first we go to the decisions under Section 18. 18 of the 1963 Act was Section 19 in the 1908 Act. So some of the old decisions you will get 19. That is present 18. Present 19 was present was Section 20 in the 1908 Act. So there is a change with respect to the numbering of the section. So some of the old decisions reference is made to Section 19 with respect to acknowledgement of liability, and Section 20 with reference to payment as provided under present 19. So that you have to take into account. Now, I will give you some decisions, some citations, and just give an indication of what it is. AIR 1991 Kerala 76, same as 1990 KHC 396, Sridevi versus Appu, that was by Justice Padmanabhan. What are the ingredients of Section 18? You will get it in paragraph 5. I will read a small portion. In order to operate as an acknowledgement under Section 18 of the Limitation Act, for the purpose of computing a fresh period of limitation, from that date, there must be acknowledgement of a subsisting liability which is not already barred. It is true that acknowledgement does not create a new right of action, but merely extends the period of limitation. It is not necessary that the statement should indicate the exact nature or the specific character of the liability, but the words used in the statement must relate to the present subsisting liability and indicate the existence of a jural relationship between the parties, such as that of a debtor and creditor, and the intention to admit such jural relationship, even though a promise to pay is not necessary. Even though a promise to pay is not necessary. That jural relationship is admitted, that the liability is subsisting is clear from the acknowledgement, that is enough. A debtor need not promise to pay. He need not do it. It is not necessary that the intention should be in express terms. It can be by implication also from the nature of the admission and the surrounding circumstances. A mere statement that the appellant's so and so facts. This is by Justice Padmanabhan. Then, AER 1991 Supreme Court, 720, same as 1990 Volume 4 SEC, 672, Narayani versus Patuma, under the Mohammedan law, a Muslim dies intestate, leaving debt and estate. What is the liability of the co-owners? Vis-a-vis 18 or 19, what is their liability? And what will happen? See paragraph 6 and 14. I will read a few sentences. Para 6. It is plain from the above quotation that the debt of the deceased gets divided in shares by operation of Muslim personal law. Amongst the heirs, proportionate to their shares in the estate. The theory of sanctity of the integrity of a debt is apparently foreign in the case of a deceased Muslim, leaving debt and some estate, both being divisible amongst his heirs. Para 14, the heirs of a Muslim dying intestate on whom falls the liability to discharge the debt, proportionate to their respective shares in the estate devolved, can hardly be classified as joint contractors, partners or executors or mortgagees, because that is reference to section 20. We'll see section 20, then come back. 20 subsection 2. Nothing in the said sections, that is 18 and 19, renders one of several joint contractors, partners, executors or mortgagees chargeable by reason only of a written acknowledgement signed by or a person made by or a payment made by or by the agent of any other or others of them. What is this? It relates to 18 and 19. Effect of acknowledgement or payment by another person. There, subsection 2, nothing in the said sections renders one of several joint contractors, partners, executors or mortgagees chargeable by reason only of a written acknowledgement signed by or payment made by or by the agent of any other or others of them. So that also we have to take into account. Here in para 14 of the decision, the heirs of a Muslim dying intestate on whom falls the liability to discharge the debt proportionate to their respective shares in the estate devolved can hardly be classified as joint contractors, partners, executors or mortgagees. As held above, they are by themselves independent debtors. And the debt having been split by operation of law, inter se, they have no jural relationship of co-debtors or joint debtors so as to fall within the shadow of contractors, partners, executors or mortgagees or in a class akin to them. The Muslim heirs inter se have no such relationship, is what is held. Next, AER 1991, Kerala, 83, same as 1990, Kerala High Court cases, 477. Craft Center and others, versus the Concheri Coir Factories. Concheri Coir Factories by Justice Padmanabhan. Two or three sentences I will read. If the plaintiff relies on an acknowledgement to save limitation, he should plead and prove the same. There can be no reliance placed on the acknowledgement not pleaded at least by way of amendment. Acknowledgement, if it is not pleaded, it does not save limitation. So when an acknowledgement is pleaded, it must be proved. How? Not by parole evidence. The acknowledgement in writing, it must be in writing. Produce that acknowledgement. Acknowledgement, oral evidence. Acknowledgement in order to save limitation must be in writing and signed by the party. No oral evidence will be sufficient if the document is not brought before court. To save the plaintiff which is ex facie barred by limitation, getting admission by the defendant is not sufficient. A roving inquiry the court will not do. Fishing inquiry the court will not do. If you are relying on an acknowledgement, where is the acknowledgement? Produce it. Let the court see. See the wording, whether it amounts to an acknowledgement or not, whether the various ingredients are satisfied or not. It is not by your oral evidence that is to be decided by the court. And it is not by putting some questions to the defendant and then getting some answers and then making out a case. That is not to be done. It has to be produced, not by parole evidence. It has to be produced for the consideration of the court. If you are relying on an acknowledgement, it must be produced. It must be pleaded. It must be proved. Because very serious consequences follow. Fresh period of limitation will start from the date of acknowledgement. So if a suit is to be, if a plaint is presented, it is apparently out of time. Beyond 3 years or 3 years, let us take 3 years is the period. 3 years, beyond 3 years from the date of this document under which the liability arises. Beyond 3 years. The plaintiff relies on an acknowledgement. That acknowledgement must be pleaded. It must be proved also. At least by way of amendment of the plaintiff, you have to plead. That is what he said in this decision. Next is AER 1975 Kerala 91. Parallel citation 1975 KLT 718. Division bench. Patuma BV and others versus Rajakrishna Menon and another. Rajakrishna Menon and another. 1 of several Mohammedan co-heirs making part payment of debt. Since they succeed to estate of the deceased in severalty, no single and indivisible debt to which the payment by one heir can be related cannot be availed to save limitation against other heirs. That we have seen in the Supreme Court decision earlier. Same principle. Para 12 detailed discussion is there. There is reference to a Calcutta decision, 1937 Calcutta. There it is said, we do not wish to express our final and concluded opinion as to whether the co-heirs of the deceased Mohammedan executant of a promissory note are joint contractors or not within the meaning of section 21(2). Within the meaning of section 21(2) is different. 21(2) is by mistake it is said here. Next is AIR 2014 Kerala. 2014 Kerala 118. Francis PJ and another versus PJ Anthony and others. Mortgage. It was held that an acknowledgement by the mortgagor after parting with the mortgaged property cannot be recognized as a valid acknowledgement so as to bind the assignee or to keep alive the liability on the mortgaged property, foreclosure and sale, etc. Then the effect of mortgagor had lost all interest in the mortgage property, could not by an acknowledgement by the payment or interest on the principal bind the person on whom his interest has devolved. It must involve an admission of a subsisting jural relationship between the parties and the consciousness and the intention of continuing such a relationship. What is this? A person is a mortgagee, he has got mortgage right. He is entitled to continue in possession. And the party to the mortgage transfers the property. He cannot bind the transferee. He can bind the transferee by expressly mentioning in the deed of transfer. Otherwise, just a mention of the liability without expressing its acceptance, without expressing its subsistence, without expressing the jural relationship, that will not bind the transferee. There is a decision by Justice Ravindran of the Supreme Court. I will state that decision in detail, then it will be very clear. Then ILR 2011-1 Kerala. ILR 2011-1 Kerala. 361. Same as 2011-1 Kerala High Court cases. 438. That I am not discussing here because I have already cited that decision for your consideration while dealing with section 10. That is a construction of a church building and all those things. I have done it. I have discussed it. Next is ILR 1991-1 Kerala. ILR 1991-1 Kerala 29. Same as 1990 Kerala High Court cases 592. Jai Hind Oil Mills versus Kerala Electrical and Allied Engineering Company. Again by Justice Padmanabhan. So all the major decisions on that question, section 18 or 19, say is by him, by his lordship. Acknowledgement under section 18 must be in writing, signed before the expiration of the period. Acknowledgement can be proved only by signed writing and not by parole evidence. All these principles have been stated in paragraph 5 and para 5 itself. Para 5 and 6. It's discussed in detail. If there is an acknowledgement under 18, it must be in writing, signed before the expiration of the period of limitation. The acknowledgement could be proved only by the signed writing and not by parole evidence. If exclusion of period is claimed under 19 on the basis of payment, it must also be before the period of limitation. And the acknowledgement of payment must appear in the handwriting of or in a writing signed by the person making the payment or an authorized agent. It is true that though the payment must be within time, the acknowledgement can be out of time also, provided it is before suit. Proof of acknowledgement by payment could only be by writing so signed. The acknowledgement, whether under 18 or 19, must be specifically pleaded in the plaint and proved by the signed writing. So we will all, I will also cite some more decisions. Then we will go to section 19, a few decisions, and then I think that will be enough for the purpose of your study. So we will see in the next episodes, because time is running out. We will see in the next episode. Thank you.